Kenya reopens doors for Uganda's Lato Milk. Oil pipeline financing to close this year, says ECOP. Tourism on a growth trajectory, according to a new report. Kenya's trade surplus with Africa rises. And KQ posts worst loss ever of $290 million in a decade. You know what? The whole conversation of Kenya and Uganda and their business deals, Lato now, you know, the gates are opened again. Before you realize, we'll be talking standards and no, we don't want your milk, or we don't want your maize, we don't want your... I keep saying these things need to be addressed once and for all. We can't keep doing the back and forth thing. If you're going to take our stuff, take. If you don't want, tell us and we think otherwise. Look, I just think these are some of the things we should be talking right now, yeah? Like, we cannot just keep hiding from reality. So at one moment, you're telling the guys, the manufacturers, all is well, you can come through. Then all of a sudden, because you feel now the demand has gone down and you feel, oh, our farmers and manufacturers equally need to benefit from the available market. Let's stop products from Uganda. Let's first deal with our Kenyan products. And then later when you need them, we'll count them back. Business doesn't work like that. If you're going to work with us, work with us. If you're not, tell us so we can think otherwise. Look, I'm not sounding tough. I just think we deserve better as the business community from Uganda. And we can only hope that this is addressed. Of course, with the latest protest in Kenya, all this just caused fear for us. But we can only hope that everything is fixed within time and business gets back as usual. Welcome to the show. My name is Simon. This is what is coming up tonight.
We all, yeah, I may be well off, but I still have relatives who are not. So by helping them, I'm relieved. They won't even tire my own children.
That's right.
Once you empower them with a skill. And also the people I train, they are the same people who come and work.
Once again, welcome to the show. Now, this week, we continue with part two of the interview that we did have with the Executive Director of Uganda Manufacturers Association, Dr. Ezra Muhumza. And the conversation is around land acquisition for production. Now, that is one thing that currently is disturbing them. The whole concern of local communities, local government, to minister should intervene, according to the ED, is slowing progress in investment, because sometimes deals are cut, investors are here, and you cannot access land. Okay? This week, we continue with that conversation, and also we look at the different plans they have, including widening the industrial parks beyond Namamve, Mbarara, and now they are targeting Gulu and other parts of the country. Of course, we know they are in Bal already. So let's just go through this conversation and let's talk how to improve investment in this country. Views from the top. So we talked about primary basic goods and high-tech industries, and you know, we talked about the issue of financing. Maybe you would want to throw more light on where exactly, as a country, which part of industries we are focusing on and what needs to be done.
The category of industries is normally in three categories. We have got the primary industries, we have basic commodity industries, and high-tech industries, as you put it. We find that the 3 decades that Ugandan industrialization process has undergone concentrated so much on the basic commodities industries, which is okay, but we had thought that primary industries was going to be a preserve of government. But along the way, we are realizing that time is now when we have to rethink construction of primary industries, because primary industries are normally the source of income in the pocket of the consumers for basic commodities and high-tech commodities. And high-tech commodities, because they are capital intensive, is the phase now we are entering into. For instance, we already have in our industrial parks companies that are now started assembling TVs, telephones, electronics. We already, that's a move towards high-tech industries.
Yes.
But again, we still think that there is unfinished agenda with primary industries. So one way we are trying to do this is to ensure that we create multi-purpose industrial fund where fund money of capital is aggregated through various channels of funding using the industrialists that are in existence in Uganda, aggregating money from government, aggregating money from commercial banks, from development banks, and a fund is created to drive the primary industry agenda.
You mentioned phones and televisions, but I know this kind of comes through with the Bobo. You had a recent meeting here with some dealers and the manufacturers of these phones. What do you think needs to be done to help Ugandans first accept that these things can actually be manufactured from here and still meet standards? And two, for the consumers, what does this then mean to them in terms of pricing of commodities?
I want to reach out to the viewers of this show and to all Ugandans that there are certain things that we need to deconstruct. One, the thinking that what is produced locally is of low quality is null. It's null thinking. In Uganda, we produce things that meet the standards, are of high quality, and there is evidence to that. Number two, to think that price means quality is a myth. Products that are produced here compared to those that are coming from outside are cheaper because they are not including, the prices are not including the cost of transporting these things, the taxes of importing, and all these other costs that are associated with the importation of things into the country. But on the market, there is a perception that anything that is cheaper is therefore of low quality. Things that are expensive are of high quality. That is one of the things that we reach out under the Bubu campaign, we want to deconstruct. And people understand that take a good as it is, once it has been certified, it has meets the standards of the National Bureau of Standards, it is good for consumption, it's good for use.
But you've been, this Bubu campaign has been here for some time now. Do you think you are slowly starting to see the impact from whatever, you know, I would want to call it whatever noise you have made out as Uma towards Ugandans?
Yes, we are moving, but we are not about to stop. We appreciate that there is a paradigm shift from the thinking, as I explained, that Ugandan things are not good. We realized that Ugandan things have not been on a tick list for most of the consumers because they did not know. So going forward, we are trying to intensify sharing of knowledge as one of the strategies. Secondly, we want to engage chain stakeholders from a manufacturer to the consumer. There are so many players in there. They have a role to play, including supermarket owners. Supermarket owners play a very big role in how they display the Ugandan products, in how they explain Ugandan products, in how they give feedback to the industrialists so that they can change or up or improve where the consumer recommends. So we are reaching out with those strategies. Then the other thing is to ensure that a product, we are no longer selling a product alone. A product involves a process. We want to reach out to people to understand the processes, what is going in inside these industries. Very few people, and I would believe that there is intensive na high-tech machinery in most of these industries. Mm. But because they rarely go there to see, they don't know. So we want to increase their visibility, we want them to be part of the process that manufacture these products. Mm. And then who produces? In our Bubu agenda, we want to ensure that people know who is producing what, such that the whole brand name, from the entrepreneur to the factory, to the name of the company, to the factory that makes this, to the process that makes this, up to the product, is looked at as a one whole set.
Okay.
Of the product or brand that you are buying.
All right. So one of the stories that, you know, have been making headlines has been Kenya and Uganda, the so-called ban on, you know, dairy products. It's been back and forth, and when the presidents sit, sometimes it looks like all is okay. But as manufacturers, what does this mean in the future for you? And do you think at one point we might have to start looking for options for our dairy products?
I wouldn't want to talk about dairy products alone. The integration, which is a regional block, is for almost all the products. Mm. When we are doing the nomenclature, we are not looking at one product like only dairy. And then again, when I would want us to perceive it from a general perspective, that the integration is a learning process. Mm. Hiccups will always be there. So hiccups come because sometimes misinterpretation, sometimes some technical people or political people have their own interests. We don't want to concentrate too much on that. We want to look at that as just a shock, and we thank government, the governments in the region who go ahead to solve these issues. But having the East African trade bloc does not mean that we don't develop other blocs. Our agenda right now is to ensure Uganda competitive leverages competitive advantage in the East African continental free trade zone is now what is preoccupying us. We want to continue to engage other regions. IGAD is a very good region to engage in. SADC, COMESA, we are engaging all these. We are now moving to the Arab world in the northern, the Maghreb. All these, we were interested in not selling the space, we're interested in selling the products.
Okay.
Wherever a product is attracted is where we want to reach. So our role as manufacturers or as the Women's Secretariat is to ensure ensure engagement with the government to open for us doors, and then we start to take products.
So what a better way to make it happen? We keep talking about unemployment in this country, but if we can spread these industrial parks across the country, then maybe a guy in Gulu won't want to work in Namanve, because then the different companies will be in their home district, and as a result, they can get jobs, but also the cost of living for them will somehow go down, because they don't have to spend so much on rent, food, transport to work. So I think it's a good move for UMA to talk about decentralizing the different industrial parks in the country. Okay, amazing conversation, and you can be a part of the next conversations coming through next week. We'll be having a different topic still and a different guest, so feel free to get in touch with us. Otherwise, you're watching The Business Show with me, Simon. Time now for a quick break on the program. When I get back, I'll be talking equally part two of Sarah, how passion was turned into money. In the meantime, feel free to get in touch with us on our socials. I'll see you shortly.